We also have a big impact test, which is done right at the very end, that level of deceleration, which would be quite unpleasant for your average human.
Welcome to our CrowdStrike safety series. Designed to cocoon and protect the two most critical elements of a Formula One car, the driver and the fuel, the survival cell, or chassis, as it's commonly known, is crucial to the overall safety structure, but also the design of the car. It's an area that has evolved massively since it was first introduced in the 1960s, and it now represents the highest standards of safety and testing in Formula One. Let's get into it. Jason, thank you so much for joining us today. Just so we can get our bearings a little bit, when we talk about the survival cell, which part of the car are we actually looking at?
So basically, the survival cell starts here, which is where the nose meets the car. So you'll see that typically when they change the front wing during the pit stop. And it runs all the way back to, roughly speaking, where the E of the INEOS sign is on the side of the car there.
It has to be designed within the FIA dimensional limitations, the safety regulations, but it's also asked to bring performance to the car. So how do we prioritise each of those needs?
Typically, the dimensional side will be taken care of quite early on in the process. The safety side of it, we optimise all of the structure for the minimum mass, which is where we get our performance from. But we're also looking at things like stiffness and the compliance of all the suspension mounting, so how much they move relative to the wheel.
So how long does each chassis take to make? And then how many would we make over a course of a season?
A chassis would be something in the order of 6 to 8 weeks. A typical season now under the cost cap, probably 3 to 4 chassis, I would say, would be normal.
So it's designed to protect the driver and the fuel. How do we achieve those huge levels of protection?
So that's very much a multi-layered approach. So we start off with small test panels, and that panel has to take 250 kilonewtons, which is 25 tons or 2.5 London buses in Old English. We also have a big impact test, which is done right at the very end. That's around about 55 to 60 G into the complete structure. So if you imagine being sat in the car, that we have a dummy that endures that level of deceleration, which would be quite unpleasant for your average human.
Absolutely, I mean, huge numbers that we're talking about that it's designed to withstand. When do these tests actually take place? I'm assuming it's somewhere around the beginning of the year ahead of the following season.
Typically, we would do perhaps some small-scale test pieces with an FIA delegate that supervises every test. The guys and girls would be doing that for 2 days. To apply numbers that we're talking about, 300 kilonewtons and 30 tons, that takes quite a lot of kit to be able to apply forces like that.
So obviously those are the tests that we have to pass at the beginning of the season to be able to go racing. As we go through the calendar, how do we check the structural integrity of the chassis after a race, whether that's, you know, during normal running of the car or if there's been an incident?
So basically we have a lot of sensors on the car during each event. In the event of an accident, for example, detecting what sort of G the car's seen. So when those are exceeded, it triggers off a series of different processes. Then there will be a lot of NDT processes or non-destructive testing. Some can be done at the track, but it'd be done more thoroughly typically at the back of the factory.
Jason, thank you so much for your time. It's fascinating to learn just how safe the survival cell is designed to be.